Well, ladies and gentlemen, our panel discussion is on mobile branding beyond Google and Facebook, where we're going to explore questions like, are there really any options beyond Google and Facebook for mobile branding in India? If yes, what are those? Have clients and agencies tried anything different, and has it worked? How important is mobile branding to clients and agencies, and where do we currently stand, and what's the future for brands advertising in mobile? We're also going to look at how they need to diversify across platforms, moving beyond Google and Facebook, and are their spends increasing on mobile? And possibly, we're also going to explore case studies if time permits. This session, ladies and gentlemen, will be moderated by the General Manager of Cheetah Mobile's Asia Pacific and Global Performance Business, who, with over 10 years of experience across product management, sales, and marketing, has successfully established Cheetah Mobile's ad sales and marketing teams as an industry-leading mobile advertising team. Ladies and gentlemen, our moderator for this session is Morden Chen, GM APAC, Cheetah Mobile. I'm now also going to call upon our panelists for this discussion. We have the Marketing Manager, Digital Reliance Mutual Fund, Himanshu Agarwal. We also have the Head Marketing at Birla Sun Life Asset Management Company, the Investment Manager of Birla Sun Life Mutual Fund, Molly Kapoor. We're also going to be joined by the VP and Digital Marketing Head, Godrej, Pankaj, Parihar. Joining us also for this discussion is Chief Digital Officer, Mindshare, Vinod, Thadani. We also have with us MD, Isobar, Shamsuddin, Jasani. And I'd also like to call forward the Head of Audience Development Discovery, Vednarayan Sirdesh Pandey. Ladies and gentlemen, can we have a round of applause for our panel? Mr. Chen, all yours.
So shall we get started now? Is it? Okay, cool. So, hi everybody, it's Morden Chen. As you can see, I guess I'm the only very few Chinese faces here. I'm working on the Cheetah Mobile. Cheetah Mobile is a mobile publisher, so we make apps. We make apps that lots of people using. We have more than 600 million users worldwide. And in India itself, we have a lot. We have more than 80 million. So we are big in India as well. And we also serve as a publisher to serve our advertisers and agencies to help advertisers reach their audiences. Okay, using a very strong mobile advertising solution that we can have. But today, the topic is all about why Google and why Facebook. So I recently found out a piece of news from eMarketers. eMarketers says in North America, back in 2016, so 99% of the mobile investment from advertisers goes to Facebook and Google. I don't have the same number for India as well because they don't have that figure. I tried. eMarketers doesn't give that to me. But I will say that's very similar, could be very similar here. So my first question to the panelists today will be, what was the forces that make that happen? Why advertisers kind of like being kidnapped by using only Facebook and Google on mobile? So here we have a agency side and customer side. How about let's start from agency side? Yep. Go ahead. Oh, this will be a very interesting talk. So everybody, please jump up with your question.
Hello.
Yeah.
So just to answer your question, I won't say that it is 90% or 95% for the big two which you named, and for obvious reasons. I think we as an industry or we as an agency and the clients definitely don't want to put all the eggs under one or two big baskets. But having said that, I think currently in India, specifically in India today, there are a lot many more publishers and potential so-called digital either OTT players or websites which are big. And we definitely partner with them, advertise with them, and we will continue to do so. That is number one. Number two, I think with the growing rate of programmatic advertising, I think it's no more that if you're a big publisher is where you have the share of wallet. I think it's going to be audiences first. With the right kind of data segmenting for advertisers, I think it depends on which publishers gets benefited with the right kind of audiences they have. Number two. Number three, I think India being so diverse as a country, Google, Facebook can more or less rely on advertising on data, but there is so much more on tier two, tier three, where we partner with many other publishers and mobile companies as well. And number four, I think very, very clearly, it's not that we don't want to partner other people, but we also worried about other things which are currently hit the digital world, which is brand safety, viewability, and other measurement metrics. And I would love to speak, understand more from other publishers, what are their take, and we are ready to definitely support them and advertise with them in the client interest. Thank you.
Okay, these are very good points, but I want to echo a little bit. So yeah, Shams, you can help too. We talk about viewability, we talk about brand safety, and as far as I know, it's like Google and Facebook, they keep many, many data by themselves. They keep the dashboard, they keep the reporting by themselves. Third-party tracking, yeah. So how about, let's address a little bit about the transparency and the data and how much like data that worked by, like by working with different publishers that data could bring to you comparing with what working with Google and Facebook?
So I think I just wanted to first resonate what Vinod actually said was as an agency, we're always a little ahead of the curve. Agree with a lot of the points. The challenge which really faces a very old challenge which used to exist even in out-of-home where, and I'll be absolutely honest out here, is the client actually says, okay, I can't see my hoarding, where is my campaign? And majority of the clients who are not, really looking at, who are entering digital, that really is the challenge. And for them, Google and Facebook is an easy answer. Because Google and Facebook is a very known entity for them. So it actually starts from them. And there's, I mean, by default, yes, they are very strong. They have products. So I don't think that it's just going to say it's going to go away. They are still going to command a large portion because it works. It frankly speaking, it works. So with all the other advertisers, all the other publishers that are there, yes, they are adding a lot of value. So I wouldn't say that it's going to come down drastically. But yes, there is there's a lot of other publishers out there. Cheetah is there. Who are now working towards actually delivering. At the end of the day, the client wants to know, is my ad really going to the right audience or not? Because as he pointed out, programmatic is the way forward. It's about audiences and not necessarily about being seen at a particular place. Mm-hmm. As far as ad fraud, as far as viewability goes, big issue across the world. In India, that is now being discussed on a day-to-day level, and I think that's something that needs to happen. As an industry, we're working towards that. Google and Facebook, the good thing that they've done they've been honest about their mistakes. Mm-hmm. So there have been mistakes that have been committed. They've been honest and said, okay, no, wait a minute. This is an issue that's happened before anyone else has discovered that. That's kind of also played into the whole aura of Google and Facebook. So that's something that is there. But the other end, yes, what's working on everyone else is that there is third-party measurement, there is viewability that you can track. Fraud is something, a click farm just got discovered in Thailand, for example. These things are getting discovered and you need technology to do that. And that technology needs to be across all the platforms.
Yeah, so that's cool. So aside from agency side, we still have lots of customers today. So I would actually want to have each representative in this table who represent, hey, I'm a customer, saying, talk a little bit about what is like in 2017, what is like most innovative like mobile campaigns you guys have run for 2017. for this year. You can not, it could be innovative or it could be something that's special, okay? And what are the platforms you have chosen? Just make it brief a little bit, show that what you have done and why you've done so. Let's start with maybe, who wanna be the first one? Okay. Pankaj, yo.
Yep. So most innovative or closer to the heart, I would say we're working on it. Yeah, it's not been in the market. We are almost about to launch this application, and it's a branded application, but not in the brand side. It's from the mosquito killer brand called HIT, which has almost 92% market share. We are creating an application. In fact, we are about to launch that application. It's going to be in the space of platelet donor community idea, and we're not talking about brand being pushed through that application, but we want users to understand the importance of platelet donation. So people understand what is blood donation, why it is critical, but people, because dengue as a disease is really, really critical, and we still don't have antidote for that. But yeah, so as the only thing which saves life is platelet in terms of that, and we are creating that particular thing through this application. We want users to understand the importance of platelet donation. So that is one interesting piece of communication which we are driving. But of course, it's about to get launched. So yeah, that's one interesting piece. Coming to your first question, that's an interesting one, and you need to have a client's perspective on that one. Why Google and Facebook? Two particular things which I think really have worked for Google and Facebook. One being first mover advantage. Yeah. Two, and the most important one, for a brand, it is important to communicate where your consumers are.
Yeah.
Okay. So if my users and consumers and customers are there on these two platforms, I would want to prioritize that, and I would want to go there. But having said that, for last couple of years, we are seeing a lot of proliferation happening beyond YouTube and Facebook. And there are options. You talk about OTT platforms, you talk about applications, you talk about long tail, you talk about news genres which are coming on, a brand like Daily Hunt. There are lots and lots of options which are available, and we have consciously started moving beyond these two big platforms. So that's from the Godrej point of view.
That's cool. So basically, I hear one thing very key is you build up an app and do customer engagement. And that's something that's innovative. Okay, so how about Himanshu? Let's give us some cases.
So I'll address the question into two parts. First is, of course, why mobile branding has not been exploded the way it should be, considering the fact that currently all the large websites have more than 80 to 90% of the traffic come from mobile alone. So so to defining a problem statement, I feel that mobile as a platform has not been explored to its full potential. We are still here in 2017 only talking about media-led innovations or publishers at best app. But knowing the device, what I have mobile, it has more than it has the power of touch, feel, movement. So a lot of things. So innovations around that and coming up with a lot of multiple touch points for relevant engagement is where I feel a lot of us are lacking behind. Having said that, giving an inside view of Reliance Mutual Fund. So had you asked this question sometime last year, why are we not just restricting ourselves to Facebook or Google, or probably over-indexed on desktop? The primary reason was, as Pankaj rightly said, that it had a certain trust and credibility, and we wanted to go with a safer option. But with the likes of Geo, other government initiatives, and you have seen the YouTube master, the spike what has given in past. So right now I think we are at 420 million odd mobile users in India. So from having said that, so it was a mobile has now not become, so it has become the only weapon in terms of reaching out to the tier 2, 3 beyond 15 cities per se. So addressing the second point in terms of innovation, so having realized this sometime in the month of September when we launched our own app called Simply Save, which was a customer innovation on instant redemption. Typically when you invest in mutual fund, you take about 2 to 3 days to get that money back. So we had a service innovation where you can redeem instantly instead of you know, waiting for 2-3 days, and gives you return more than your typical you know, banks, or probably it's a small setup, so I can safely say FDs also. Basically, if you invest in FD, you get about 4%, 6%. Or savings account, this has a 5, over the past 3 years, it's about 8.5. So that's the indexed return you get. So we launched this app, then we realized the power of mobile because the transaction volume. So typically, the large myth, I'm sure the agency folks will agree, all the transactions are driven through desktop. So desktop, the typical point of purchase is desktop and not mobile. But if I look at my internal data for past about 8 months, we have seen that mobile contributes to about 40% of the transactions happening across mutual fund as a brand. So that's a pretty big number, which also corroborates with Google in terms of the explosion happening. And in terms of media innovation, we do a lot of you know, innovations on media. So we did some time back high beam frequency sort of testing, where multi-screen testing, basically my ad coming on TV, my and competitor ad, and then serving it with a contextual message on mobile. And we want sort of experimented which one is working, you know, better. Then I think we were the first one to sort of do the app locker innovation. So when we were launching, so build the authority affinity. So so we've been, so because for mobile, for us, it's all about engagement, contextual engagement, and having those micro segments, unlike your typical, you know, all the other platforms you have. So we've been experimenting on radio in terms of, again, there are radio apps, you know, online radio apps, and seeing whether, you know, if frequency of 4, frequency of 2, what does help in terms of the companion banner. So these are the broad innovations, you know, what I can tell. I can get into details if needed. Yeah, thanks.
So actually, that's the second time we heard about, hey, we have our own app. And this app is for more user engagement, understand our user better, getting more data. I'm not sure whether we have the same thing happen, but welcome to share about Molly. How about your company?
So, you know, I know you asked a very direct question, but probably I'll just, because, you know, everybody has apps and everybody is trying to experiment with, you know, different ways of presenting the same thing. So we have a lot of similar things which Reliance has. But, you know, I do tend to agree with what Vinod mentioned, that for us as a brand, the consumer comes first. Yeah. And therefore, we understand the journeys. And we all know, sitting in this room, that we have different behaviors at different points in time. So we are not constantly on Facebook or we are not constantly on Google, right, throughout the day. If you start the day probably with a newspaper, then you have Facebook, then you have probably a desktop, then you have newspaper or something, you know, television. So if you understand that journey and understand where your consumers are, then I feel you can give a good proposition. And you necessarily don't need to have your own platforms. There are good partners who we should smartly partner with. And, you know, and you reach the consumer. So that's your end point. That's your outcome. However, having said that, we do have apps. But again, we try to focus on simplifying the experience more than, you know, saying that, okay, we'll just go with an app or we'll just go with another platform. How do we do a seamless experience, whether website, whether app? You see us on television, you see us on radio. So, you know, what is it that we want to deliver to the consumer? So that matters the most to us as a brand. If mobile fits in, very good. If it doesn't, we'll not miss it.
Yeah.
That's
basic. All right. So, Ben, how about you?
Yeah, thanks. I think a lot has been spoken again in terms of Google, Facebook, or other platforms, et cetera, et cetera. So just wanted to make a point on the two platforms versus the other. I think it's also a function of the ecosystem that you've created around you as well. So Google and Facebook have created their own ecosystem, not just from an advertising perspective, but also from a content and creative perspective. I think that's crucial. I think agencies, and they've been the first movers, as Pankaj was saying, to partner with agencies from a creative and content perspective. And that's why clients are looking, or the creative guy who's at the agency is always thinking of Facebook and Google, purely because there are deep links that the publisher has made with the agency, whether it's a mainline agency or a digital agency. So your default brief question of what do I do innovative on a digital platform, the creative guy is already thinking Facebook and Google, subconsciously. So the choice that you're making is, or the ideas that are getting presented to the client are by default slide one, slide two, and slide three, all Google and Facebook properties.
Yeah.
So it's also a function of time spent, first mover, et cetera, et cetera. But it's also a function of where does the idea germinate from, and how deeply have they integrated their sort of thinking process, and just not about products. So if you look at the kind of white papers that Google comes up with, which is you have a hero idea, hub idea, and a hygiene idea, it's embedded with the agencies. So all of the ideas that you think of, or the new ways of digital marketing, is the Facebook and Google way of marketing. So I think the challenge is not just about ad formats or content or time spent. It's also about the process that they've created, or the framework that they've created for advertisers to get receptive to this whole piece. Mm-hmm. And obviously there's glamorous work to be seen on platforms like Facebook and Google, Twitter, Instagram. So your work is seen, as Shams was saying, in terms of where is my outdoor ad. Your ads is definitely shared and seen on these platforms. So by default, it's glamorous work for everyone, including marketeers. To your second question about innovation, I think there are a lot of non-glamorous things that can also be innovative, right? So consumers today are watching a whole lot of television or a whole lot of content on digital, and they're speaking that on Facebook and Twitter or Instagram or whatever, right? And that's rich data for us. Tell me today, every news channel has a hashtag running. There's a at handle that goes. So the amount of second screen conversation that's happening, because the mobile is always with you, is tremendous. So A, you have to address a linear plus digital audience that's there from a content perspective, and see what they are seeing and what the aspiration is from a content perspective. And the other side is really, how do I create content back to a certain audience that's speaking my content or content related to me? So I think a whole lot of innovation is happening, which is linked to data and conversations that can lead to you creating campaigns and advertising, and not just creating campaigns for the sake of creating campaigns. So two things, yeah.
Thanks.
So that's something that I wanted to just brief in, and thank you for taking that point. So the point that I want to make from an innovation perspective is that in this year, data is the new innovation, because it's really, from now on, for the next couple of years, it's really going to drive all kinds of innovation that you ever see across anything that you're doing, and especially on mobile, because the kind of data that you can get, it's about reaching as close as possible to the segment of one. How do I understand that you as an individual, and this device is actually making me understand that the most, better than any other device that actually exists out there, is who are you and what is it that you are doing, what are your likes, what are your dislikes, irrespective of you actually saying those out loud. And that really is the most powerful innovation that's coming out in anything and everything that we do. So that really is going to drive everything that we are talking about, whether it is about talking about micro segments, whether it's about talking about different kinds of content that we are, if it's talking about where should I advertise, whether Facebook or Google or Cheetah, that all is going to come upon the data that we're going to use. So extremely important for, you know, advertisers, for marketers, for publishers, is how are we actually using that data, gathering that data, and then understanding it to get better at talking to our consumers. And it also starts from the content piece as well. Is my communication strategy, is my content strategy able to deliver to that data that I'm actually talking to that consumer that I'm talking to. And I think that's really the innovation of this.
So the point that I was making is you're not consuming content, the content is also consuming you.
So
everyone knows what you're consuming. So that the back door to that content consumption habits and understanding is the innovation moving forward.
Yeah, just as an extension of the same point. Now imagine if, you know, as a brand, I'm a mutual fund brand, right? Mm-hmm. And most of my content is little serious content. It's not a content which is beautiful, okay? And so if you just extend this data perspective and go deeper into understanding behaviors. Now for Facebook, for example, there are people who are going to Facebook to relax, to socialize, right? To de-stress.
Yes.
Now when they are de-stressing, and if I present a graph of the last 1 year, 5 years, 10 years kind of returns, probably, you know, even that content, even if it is exceptionally good, will probably not be appreciated. So it depends as to, again, you know, what is the state of mind of the consumer when that content or that, you know, that when that person is on the platform. So if I were on LinkedIn, if I were on Twitter, probably my content will be more accepted.
Probably.
So behavior from insights and therefore
and
data is very, very important.
So data, behavioral insight, connect with content and connect with the advertising.
Connecting the dots is very
yes.
important, getting the right insights.
So then I come up with actually one question, really interesting, want to talk with every people here. So we hear these data, we hear about audience, how this, so what's the suggestion that you can give it out to people like us, like publishers, other than Google and Facebook? Google and Facebook, they say they own the world. I have lots and lots of data. I just don't want to share that much with you. But I want to bundle it into a product or something so that I can work on with you. But if like us, as a publisher, as a mobile publisher, what kind of corporation or what kind of data corporation that we can work with either agency side or customer side that can foster that the agency side or the customer side are much more interested in working with us. What kind of data you are looking for? What kind of insight you are looking for? Could you share a little bit as a agency side? We can start with,
Okay, I think it's a very good question, but I'll take a step back over here. So I think the first and foremost thing we need to do is we definitely need to be open source. Mm-hmm. We need to understand what are the different kinds of today data available to us. By us, I mean to the publishers and then to the agencies and clients. I think more and more you partner, more and more you understand, and to Molly's point, it's consumer centric. You need to make sure what the behavior is, and from that, you will understand what, if his behavior is X, do you have that kind of data? I'll try and give an example of two different clients. I think that's the best way to understand how you can target them better and what publishers can take from there. Let's say there is a H&I client and there is a FMCG. If I know that there is a customer who has high level of international travel, has an ARPU of more than 5,000 or 10,000 rupees. Mm-hmm. He is always staying in, if it's Bombay, south of Bombay. If he has a phone which is more than 50,000, 60,000 bucks, he's been seen in international, in five-star and seven-star hotels. I, through this data segment, I can definitely understand and target him to an H&I client.
Mm-hmm. But would you like to play more? I mean, pay more for that? Pay more
I'll come
for
to that.
That.
I'll come to that.
Okay, cool.
Right. So, data very important. Mm-hmm. Now, what does the publisher like? Your question goes.
Yeah.
What can I publish? If a publisher is open to partner with the data sources, it becomes far more easier for an agency and a client to use that publisher in the marketing or the media mix. Mm-hmm. Because you can consolidate and tell me about more about these data segments, right?
But are agencies ready for that? agency is ready for the tech impact now already?
Oh yeah, I think at least I'm sure Shamsu will talk about his agency, but at least where I come from, we are more than ready for it. We have started implementing this for clients, and I think, like they say, data is the new oil today, and that's where digital marketing is actually going. Now let me come to the another side of the consumer, advertiser, which is an FMCG. If I can understand that there is a consumer who spends X amount of money on the 29th and 30th of end of the month and on the 1st and 2nd, and he's been looked into modern trade, and he is staying 50 meters or 100 meters away from this kind of a grocery that's shop, that's kind of another data segment which I can use to target this consumer. All I'm saying is, and okay, you may ask me a question saying that if you funnel that much, how much will you reach out to these audiences? There's no point to reach out to 1,000 people in a 400 million data stack. But that's not the case. Mm-hmm. You have lot many other models for doing lookalikes and understanding how you can grow that data segment better. I'll come to your another question, which you said that if the agencies or clients are ready to pay that kind of money. I think gone are the days where we were talking about an X CPM which got fixed for a publisher. If today you can scientifically segment the audience and come back to the agency and say, these are the kind of audience and I can sharp target it, I'm sure we can justify the cost or the additional premium, so-called, which needs to be put. And I'm sure if we can do that with the client, because at the end of the day, please understand, all our business is for our clients. And the clients would definitely, rather than doing a spray, would want to target much more refiner target audiences where they can then talk about business and performance. It's no more a story of only good to do branding stuff. It's also at the end of the day where there is an ROI for every dollar which you spend on advertising.
Yeah, and therefore now I think the agency role has evolved quite a bit, and client no more is the client that agencies are serving. The client is again, you know, who are you targeting? And therefore we have to partner in whether it's like creative, whether it's data or anything, the outcome has to be same, and therefore, you know, whether it's sharing of costs or whether sharing of profits, I think that partnership is coming up between client and the, so that's an evolution that's helping.
So I have a slightly different kind of view, and that's good for the panel. So let's say that there is a Google ecosystem and then there's a Facebook ecosystem, and I'm talking from a publisher perspective, as the question was, what can a publisher like Cheetah do? There needs to be an ecosystem that exists beyond this, which I think all of the agencies are really creating today, is how am I going to get all these data points, and I think a lot of the discussions were around there, was how am I going to get the entire consumer journey with all the data points across for my consumer. The future really is about, again, the segment of one. It's about that one person and what is that one person doing. Mm-hmm. If you get the time, please go and see the Cambridge Analytics work that was done for Donald Trump winning the elections, and you'll come to know what is the kind of segmentation that happens. So just have a look at Cambridge Analytics, Donald Trump, when you search for it. That's the kind of data that people are using. It's actually to say, okay, this person who lives in this area is pro or anti a product, for example. And that's the kind of level of targeting that is going to be reached to. Are you ready for that? As an agency, we are. We're already on the way. We're already on a way of creating the segment of fun, already on a way of creating a platform which gets everything onto one to understand who that person is. And going beyond just digital data, we're talking about direct mailer data, we're talking about interactions on malls, etc. So we're going way beyond that. So that's something that's already happening. But in that ecosystem, as a publisher, how can I add to that ecosystem, number one? Number two, how can I automate? Because that's another big thing that is going to happen, is automation. Without automation, if you are not going to go into the automation game, that's going to be another miss point that's going to be there. How am I going to, how I as an agency can dip into that data without actually speaking to you? Without actually speaking to any of your guys. It's very important for me to understand that and get those data points out without it. So automation is going to be extremely important from that perspective. And then B is, of course, you need people then not to get the data, but to analyze that data. So mm-hmm. the future really belongs to people who are going to be able to get the data, analyze it, and you know, speak to our clients and really be able to make a difference in the client's business. And that's really where I think the big ticket items are.
We have something coming soon. But definitely will be something that might be making all of you guys interested in. But yeah, we still have some time. How about let customers talk? Customers, come on.
Actually, building on both these gentlemen's point, from CPG point of view, okay, look at data. I mean, I don't want to twist data so much that, you know, it starts throwing wobbly understanding. Data has to give me actionable insights, yeah, about customers, about consumers. And for a CPG client, it is very, very important. Okay, I understand that female XYZ in this metro is doing this. But what is her behavior? What are the affinities which she's getting into is very, very critical for me, because that will help me decide the kind of content I am creating. And that content will ensure that the engagement which I need to have with that kind of users will actually give that brand love or a lift which I want to have in my with my brand. So that's where I feel that, you know, publishers like you need to give us more understanding, and partners like you know, partners sitting next to me, they need to also give us understanding in terms of consumers' behavior mm-hmm. and what she's doing online, what are the affinities and interests she has. Of course, these kind of things are which we are getting through various platforms, but not at a mass scale.
Yeah, just to add to that, there is one apparent data where, you know, people are coming online and they're displaying, let's say, you know, women are coming in shopping or men are coming in buying mutual funds, etc. But then there is a lot of unsaid data which we have to understand as marketeers. So where does that come from? So for example, if the woman is buying a dress, then who are the three other friends who are influencing her mm-hmm. by that dress? Or if a man is purchasing mutual fund, then who is the actual person who's influencing him to buy mutual funds? That is something, you know, that we really want to understand on a daily basis. Now, a woman can be influencing a man in the house to buy mutual funds for all you know. Or a child could be influencing a father by, you know, the car that they choose to buy for the family. So yes. Those influencing sets also play a big role from a data perspective. So one is a straight line data, and of course, what are the influencing factors around it?
Yeah, I kind of want to build on what Pankaj was saying in terms of data can take you as much in terms of actionable executions. And I think today, everyone who's sitting here who assesses a media plan has that amount of custom targeting built into it. So I don't know how much of analyzing your TG and then having a super segmented plan will actually help you. I think it's the ability of your platform to influence the consumer and having a direct impact on the brand equity is the next layer. So I think the buildup to data is still a media plan. And after that, it's what you deploy and how does it really influence your consumer. And I think if that journey is got by a 2+ or whatever, beyond your core platforms, yeah. I think that's the game changer or the needle mover in terms of how does your platform actually influence the brand, and then people are willing to kind of put monies behind it, beyond the hygiene of targeting and the other stuff that you have, right?
I spend lots of time actually taking notes. I mean, it's not just a panel discussion. I'm actually taking notes and to be shared with my co-founders. It's true. So so because we are running out of time, I really want to have Himanshu to speak a little bit, but we try to make some time for people to do questioning. This is the last 2 minutes, and we prepared our gift for people who are willing to ask questions, okay? So any question, because this is a very rare opportunity to have a very decent, not me.
Include me.
Please include me, but very decent people, folks here. Okay, any question? There's one.
Hi, I just wanted to ask, for years, marketeers who are sitting on the panel have been spending hundreds of crores of rupees on television and print, Now you're spending 10%, 5%, 8%, or 20% of your money into digital, and suddenly the questions of vicinities and proximities and who influences and why shouldn't they, how are the influence happening? Why is so much of, you know, needle points being made towards digital data points, whereas you never cared about it earlier? So why are you being so pessimistic about digital?
Sir, we are not pessimistic about digital, trust me. We are really, really positive and gung-ho about digital. And it's not that we are pinpointing questions on data and digital. It's that, I mean, these options are available to us, right? These options are created by us as an industry. It's not that, you know, suddenly a marketer has woken up and asking this question, okay, give me this data on digital. These are things available, and rightly so. I mean, if this is available, we need to use them in right fashion. It's not that we are just saying that because this is available, I'm going to only invest 5% or 10% on this one, and I'll keep asking questions.
So, sorry, just to take a corollary to that question. So why aren't you asking the same questions for TV and print? You're spending 80% of your money there.
We are, and that's the whole idea. The idea is that we are asking those questions. The whole concept of the old adage of I don't know where 50% of my advertising dollars are going, that's not true of digital. And that's really the case with mainline, because you're taking a sample size of, I don't know, 10,000, 15,000 people meters to really go there, and you... It is the question that we are asking as digital marketers ourselves, saying that what is it that...
That's why I was asking the insurance guys.
Yeah. So
I was asking this question of the insurance guys, and the agencies are answering.
So my view will be, the reason why... So I do about 5 digital campaigns every month, okay, and maybe 1 TVC across quarter. So you can see the... So why digital as a medium has evolved, and there is a other trend called cord cutters where people don't watch TV. So definitely people are more, I'm talking about my senior folks at Reliance, are opening to digital as a medium to adopt for not only from ROI, but brand perspective also. So that's the other part why, you know, the data people are shifting more towards digital.
I think we can have an offline conversation.
I don't know if that question was to me, but I think in my last comments, I said that the impact on brand. I think what you're essentially doing is coming back to Shamsu's question, is that everyone remembers an ad. No one remembers a mobile ad, to be honest with you. If you ask, if you have a research agency who's doing your household panel, if you're doing qualitative research, everyone remembers your ad. How do you know a brand? So in multiple consumer researches that I've been to, or qualitative FGDs that I've been to, no one is talking about, I've seen your mobile ad and then I've gone and bought your product. So it's very difficult that way to be in a situation where all marketing is taught saying influence, purchase, consideration, and then purchase. And that influence is coming through ATL. And you can't deny that, because consumers are saying that I've seen this ad and I've got influenced. So it's very difficult from a digital perspective to really say that it's moving the needle from an influence perspective. I've seen this mobile ad and hence I've bought this product. So it's slightly two different parameters when you're looking at digital and mobile and ATL differently. So they're serving two different purposes here. And ultimately today, everyone is asking if your digital advertising and mobile advertising is really impacting your brand to a certain extent. And if that is, then you should double down on that, is the question. And if it's working for your brand, you should. Mm-hmm. As simple as that.
Yep. Yes. So just to add to that, there's a little different view that I have, because if you say 5%, 10%, I think that's past, clearly past in from our scheme of things, because what we believe is that our consumers are very digitally savvy, and trust me, my 50% budget is dedicated to digital. Yeah. And when we look at digital, again, there's a misnomer, because digital is not what you just see on the platforms. There's a lot of investment that goes behind digital to put it up there, right? In IT, infrastructure, and you know, on your servers, on your software, applications, etc. So there's a lot of investment that goes behind. So if you add up all of that, it's probably much more than 50%.
That's probably.
Also, one last point. TV doesn't know you, print doesn't know you, but your mobile knows you. It's your personal device. Hence, data is available. Hence, it's been asked for sharper targeting, contextual communication.
Well, I just hate to interrupt.
One second. Just to add, I think you raised a point which I think always gets raised between when we are in boardrooms with clients and saying that, you know, your 90%, your 95% of your monies are on traditional media, and your 5 or 10% monies are on digital, and you, and as digital marketeers or agencies, we get asked the maximum amount of questions, but television and offline media doesn't get that, and it's always the case. I think now, I would like to believe, gone are the days that these questions are asked anymore. I think as an integrated agency, we generally try and put the idea to the client on the table and give the medium its due benefit. Having said that, it can never be 80% or 85%, sir, but we're definitely moved beyond the 5% or 7% mark, because it's no more what in digital or why digital, it's how digital, what you can do there. And just to add to Molly's point, I think there are clients which are not even in the bracket of 10% and 15% because their business either is on digital and hence they need to do, and also offline clients where they have understood the power of digital and they use digital for business acquisitions and not only for marketing.
Well, that's all the time we have, Mr. Chen. Thank you so much. Before we let our panelists go, Mr. Chen, I'm going to request you to kindly present them with a token of our gratitude. Thank you very much to all our panelists for that very, very insightful and enthusiastic discussion.